Please rise. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In the waters of baptism, Dorothy died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May she now share with him eternal glory. In baptism, Dorothy received the sign of the cross. May she now share in Christ's victory over sin and death.
Thank you. A reading from the book of Sirach. Now will I praise those gods of people, our ancestors, each in his own time. These were godly people, whose virtues have not been forgotten. Their wealth remains in their families, their heritage with their descendants. Through God's covenant with them, their family and yours, their posterity for their sake. And for all time, their progeny will endure. Their glory will never be blotted out. Their bodies are peacefully laid away, but their name lives on and on. At gatherings, their wisdom is retold, and the assembly proclaims their praise. The word of the Lord. Responsorial song. The Lord is my light and my salvation.
The Lord is my light and my
help. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Before whom shall I shrink?
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
There is one thing I ask of the Lord, for this I long: to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to savor the sweetness of the Lord, to behold his temple.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
O Lord, hear my voice when I call, have mercy and answer. It is your face, O Lord, that I seek. Hide not your face.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
I am sure I shall see the Lord's goodness in the land of the living. Hope in him, hold firm and take heart. Hope in the Lord.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
A reading from the second letter to Timothy. For I am already being poured out like a libation, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have competed well. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, the crown of righteousness awaits me, which the Lord, the just judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearance. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you.
Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit upon his glorious throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him, and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep on his right, the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. A stranger and you welcomed me. Naked and you clothed me. Ill and you cared for me, in prison and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him and say, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and visit you?' And the king will will say to them in reply, Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of these least brothers of mine, you did for me. Then he will say to those on his left, Depart from me, you accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. A stranger, and you gave me no welcome. Naked, and you gave me no clothing. Ill and in prison, and you did not care for me. And they will answer and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or ill, or in prison, and not minister to your needs? He will answer them, Amen, I say to you, what you did not do for one of these least ones, you did not do for me. And these will go off to eternal punishment, the righteous to eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. Well, I admit, I never got to know Dorothy, but from what I've heard from you over the last few days, it seems she was one who kept the Lord's greatest commands. She loved God first, and all of you second. She loves all of us here, sure, but she hoped to see the Lord, and someday she hopes to see all of us there by her side, in his presence. But that is not assured. We need to remember that. In our gospel reading this morning, Jesus said that when he comes again, he will judge us. His judgment and our eternal abode, heaven or hell, will depend in part on whether or not each of us sought him, Jesus, and served him in this life. And that makes sense. You know, if we don't seek him out now, he will not force us to be with him forever in heaven. He loves us, so he respects our free will. And where do we seek and find the Lord then? Well, in prayer and worship, especially in the Holy Eucharist. But also, as we heard in the readings, in those whom we are called to serve, the hungry, the thirsty, the stranger, the naked, the ill, those in prison. Jesus goes so far as to say that when we serve those persons generously, we are serving him. And when we refuse to serve those persons, we are refusing to serve him. What you did for these least brothers of mine, you did for me. What you did not do for one of these least ones, you did not do for me. Now, of course, I'm not Dorothy's judge. That's Jesus' job. But I've heard numerous people say she never met a stranger, that everyone was welcome, that she was generous in serving others, in feeding and caring for all of you and serving others. She served Christ. Last night, many of you, thank you for sharing your beautiful memories, you praised Dorothy for her faith. And she served this parish for years, in many different ways. I'm told she was a woman of deep prayer, who loved Jesus. And from what I've heard from you, it seems that that relationship is very real. That it wasn't just something kind of academic, that it wasn't just something kind of traditional. She knew, and now we pray, she really knows Jesus. As Dorothy lived her life, and as she approached her last years, at least this much is very evident to me, she kept an eternal perspective. She remembered that this world wasn't the goal, and she longed for heaven. You shared a few stories with me, in fact, over the last few days that made that obvious. As much as she loved all of you and enjoyed this world, she once said, I don't want to be here. I want to be there. She pointed to heaven. And again, that just calls to my mind those two greatest commandments, which summarize all the others. Love God first, with all we have and are, and then love our neighbor as ourselves. Dorothy loved God more than anything, and that love only strengthens her love of others, all of you. And Dorothy also said, I keep knocking, but obviously Jesus isn't ready for me. She's ready. And not long ago, a couple of you told me, I heard this story a couple of times, maybe while she was a bit sleepy, I hope I get the details right here, but Dorothy woke up and she said, I'm dead. Then, as you tell the story, she held up her hands and fidgeted with her rings, because apparently she really liked her jewelry. And then she said, oh, not yet. But then, not long before her death, and this is just beautiful, apparently she said, Jesus is coming. He's ready. I'm ready too. Given that she had a visit from a priest, I assume she died with the sacraments, all the graces Jesus could offer her. So she was ready. And I can only hope that you and I are as ready when our days inevitably come. So I just say Dorothy's faith was worthy of imitation. And just think, I doubt anything would please her more than watching from on high her children, her grandchildren, great-grandchildren, learning, living, practicing, and then handing on the beautiful Catholic faith that she found so much value in, that inspired such virtue and holiness in her. She wants you to receive that gift and pass it on to the next generations. With St. Paul, I think Dorothy could say, I have finished the race. Kept the faith. She's certainly one of those who, like St. Paul, long for his appearance. But if there's anything at all delaying her entrance into the glories of heaven, if there's any little imperfections, we now continue today offering the most powerful prayer there is, the holy sacrifice of the Mass, which is the sacrifice of Jesus himself for the repose of her soul. May she hear those beautiful words, come, you blessed heretic. Please rise. Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to his.
The response is, Lord, hear our prayer. In baptism, Dorothy received the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead her over the waters of death. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Our sister Dorothy was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome her into the halls of the heavenly banquet. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Many friends and members of our families have gone before us in the way to the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. We pray to you, Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Those who trusted in the Lord now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all whose faith is known to you alone. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The family and friends of Dorothy seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come with grief. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our sister Dorothy. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your son's coming. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ. Grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this in Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Saddened by the certainty of dying, might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more gave thanks. Gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Mystery of faith.
Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and David our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember your servant Dorothy, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she, who is united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your grace. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Peace of the Lord be with you always. Just a brief word about the reception of Holy Communion. Anyone who's Catholic and not aware of any unconfessed mortal sin is welcome to come forward and receive Holy Communion. If you're Catholic and you don't think that you're ready to receive Communion, or if you're not Catholic, you can remain in your pew, or if you do come forward, just cross your hands over your chest, indicate to me that you would just like me to offer you a blessing. Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey, mercifully grant us strength and vital, our sister Dorothy may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express our affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day, we shall joyfully greet her again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Thank you. sight. 12 years ago, almost 12 years ago, Mom Dorothy called me and asked me to eulogize her beloved friend. The last time in this church was our beloved Aunt Stella. I have the privilege to be up here to look out and see people, see this family congregation. I want to thank you. I want to thank you, and I want to thank the Lord for allowing me to be a part of you. Lori, Bruce, Michelle, Ryan, this is truly an honorable day. This last week, I came back from Minneapolis. I watched a lot of baseball. My grandfather, I get around more now than I ever have. We were at a university called Northwestern that I did not know existed. It was in St. Paul. And we had a rain delay. And this was the most beautiful campus. And I went for a walk in the rain. And I came across this lake and this sign. And on the sign it said, Billy Graham. I said, my God, Billy Graham is the originator, the starter of this great university. And it was just beautiful. And what came to mind was how much I liked Billy Graham and how he could grab my attention and what a leader he was. And I thought of a sermon once where he actually started a sermon with commitment, and there was a young lady had never been married, and she was a farm girl, and she'd go out for walks at night. And as she's walking around, there was a wise old owl up in a tree, and it was going, hoo, hoo, hoo. She says, I'll take anybody. Billy Graham had me, and then he went to another one. She went to a palm reader, and the palm reader said, you will have three potential goals that will propose marriage to you. And she said, well, that's not true. She said, because I'll take the first one. Billy Graham had me. Dorothy, Irene, Grant, Cordy, has me. The ninth child of Robert and Gertrude. Moved to Minot 10 years later, 1942. Ended down the fairgrounds, Sunnyside School, Roosevelt Park. She worked at the Whisper Barrel at one time. Can you imagine her serving cars on roller skates? I could see Dorothy doing that. And she loved that place. And I loved the fairgrounds, the playground. She'd swing me, she babysat us kids. I could go on and on about my childhood, but Dorothy and the Fone sisters were incredible. The seven Fone sisters. You know, I wrote a few notes down, and when I say Fone sisters, I also wrote down in parentheses, love. You go right down the line with Helen, Margaret, Millie, Stella, Donna, Dorothy, Patsy. You go right down the line. That whole family, as I was growing up today, driving up here to Bristol, I hadn't been here for a while. I had to drive around and see the sights. And they're great memories. Uncle Howard, Aunt Lois, my godparents live right over here. Roger and I used to sneak into the gym on Sundays, go out through the basement windows. And I can remember Howard and Lois living out by the tracks. And then we go to Stanley and the other brothers, Gordon and Bob. Robert stood up last night, and I thought really, really me about what the importance of family is. You know, I get going, and I have a habit sometimes, I'll see somebody in his hands over the wall, don't get too long, and you know, you have your critics, but I, these memories that float through my mind now are family memories. Bruce and Uncle Paul put together some video, and I have to talk about this because it is one of my favorites. My all-time athletic experience was playing with the Bruce old cousins. My cousins would give me some static about being a big city boy. They had something to do with that, I guess. But here I was a good old farmer for a while. And but the beauty, I'm having a bad day, I can plug in that old VHS. And you know what I see now, 40-some years later? I see Dorothy in the stands rocking a baby. I see Aunt Donna with the biggest smile on her face. And our Uncle Clifford, who carried off the floor. So this, I know wherever he's at, he's saying that was a highlight of his athletic career. But what made us good, what made us do what we did, it wasn't from us. It was from our family. A tremendous family that I'm so proud of. This great poem, Oscar Hammerstein in the 40s wrote it. And I don't know where I picked it up, but it is Dorothy. A bell isn't a bell unless it's rung. A song isn't a song unless it's sung. The love we've been given isn't meant to stay. Love isn't love until you give it away. Last night, I've never heard so many heartfelt statements, so many heartfelt, loving, committed, genuine. The word be quieted, I looked up the other day, I heard it in a dream, and it's Dorothy. She did not have a narcissistic bone in her body. She was giving. She was loving. It was genuine. I said Billy Graham was my hero. Dorothy Cordy is my hero. She has led me. Dorothy lived to be 90 years old. And she had some heart issues, she had some health issues, and we talked about longevity. Dorothy lived, not because of the health of her real heart, it was her faith in that heart of giving that has given us this family, friends, and especially me. She has given me strength. Dorothy Eileen Grant Cordy. I love you. I feel you. My parents died 40 years ago, 43 years ago, and I almost wanted to quit on life. I didn't think, I thought at that time that I'd lost it. How wrong could I have been? How right was Dorothy telling us that? That spirit lives. Dorothy lives. Dorothy lives today, and I believe that. I've never believed it more. And it's because of Dorothy Eileen Grant Cordy. Favorite prayer of mine is a benediction. It's about the Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Dorothy, thank you. your brave life. Thank you, people.
Thank you.